Layer 7. Congratulations on making it this far. Now we're in the deepest layer in one of the most thorny subjects, not only in physics, not only in math, but in all fields imaginable. It's useful to understand the math of string theory, even if string theory ends up missing the mark, because the problems being addressed here are problems at the heart of the physical universe. However, of course, you shouldn't mistake the physical universe as being synonymous with reality. This is a point that Hilary Putnam makes. Despite this, understanding string theory gives you a bedrock at the fount of reality, the reality that can be established mathematically and logically. Let's get on with the iceberg. No precise statement and derivation of ADS-CFT. This is a grueling problem in physics. We often assume that there is such a correspondence, which is just yet to be found rigorously, but even defining it rigorously is formidable. Further, there are 9 major problems. Number 1, mapping between gravitational and field theory configurations. The issue is to find an exact dictionary that conjoins gravitational states with the states of the boundary conformal field theory. When you have configurations with less symmetry, it's not clear how to do this. Number 2, ADS space as a regulator for flat space physics. The use of ADS space as a regulator to extrapolate to flat space physics involves taking the limit where the ADS radius of curvature r goes to infinity. This process, while keeping the local physics unchanged, isn't fully developed, especially in understanding how the ADS boundary conditions translate to flat space observables. Number 3, holography in light-like boundaries. Understanding holography for light-like boundaries, as in the case of Minkowski spacetime, differs significantly from time-like boundaries typical of ADS-CFT. The existence and nature of large n limits for theories that aren't gauge theories and for theories with less or no supersymmetry isn't anywhere as developed either. Number 5, sub-ADS locality. How do you understand the emergence of bulk physics at scales smaller than the ADS radius? The solvable models we have currently of holography don't capture the locality expected from gravity in the bulk, which should be evident at scales much smaller than this radius. Number 6, time evolution. The bulk reconstruction techniques developed so far primarily address static or equilibrium situations. The dynamical evolution of non-trivial states, particularly those involving black hole formation and thermalization, aren't well understood. Gravitational dressing, number 7. Bulk operators must be dressed gravitationally to be gauge invariant, but the precise nature of this dressing in context with significant back reaction isn't fully understood as well. Dressing in this context, by the way, means incorporating the influence of gravitational fields generated by the operator itself on its definition, ensuring diffeomorphism invariance. This is particularly relevant for operators that couple strongly to gravity. Number 8, entanglement wedge reconstruction. So the conjecture that the boundary subregion R is dual to the entanglement wedge W rather than to the causal wedge CR raises the question about the reconstruction of these bulk operators. The entanglement wedge can extend beyond the causal wedge, potentially including regions behind horizons, which complicates the understanding of bulk locality and the encoding of bulk information in the boundary theory. By the way, the entanglement wedge refers to the region of spacetime in the bulk that can be reconstructed from boundary subregion entanglement, while the causal wedge is the bulk region causally connected to that boundary subregion. And lastly, number 9, black hole interior. The description of the black hole interior is still an open problem in ADS-CFT. What is the existence of firewalls? What is the fate of an infalling observer? We don't know. Fuzzballs and the microstructure of black holes.
The fuzzball proposal in string theory suggests that black holes possess a microstructure composed of stringy excitations, or fuzzballs, which replace the classical event horizon, as well as the singularity.
This stems from the correspondence between black holes and D-brain bound states. It's an attempt to describe the near-horizon geometry using the dual conformal field theory. To translate that a tad, the fuzzball conjecture replaces the mysterious core as well as the edge of black holes with information-storing strings. The Bekenstein-Hawking formula agrees with the degeneracy of these fuzzball states, accounting for the microstates that generate the black hole entropy.
The fuzzball conjecture was first proposed by string theorist Mathur and his collaborators in 2002.
You'll hear this term plenty, microstructures and microstates. To be specific, the microstructure generally refers to the arrangement of string excitations that comprise the black hole's interior, while microstates are these distinct field configurations that these excitations can take, each one corresponding to a unique quantum state. Essentially, they represent the different ways that strings can vibrate or be bound together within the fuzzball, giving rise to the black hole's entropy. Now, how do you generalize these fuzzballs not only to non-extremal black holes, but to other broader classes of black holes? This is an open problem. Also, what's the exact mechanism for retrieving information from these fuzzballs?
We don't know. But the answer to these can help resolve the black hole information paradox. So, good luck. Background independence and challenges. Achieving background independence in string theory remains a large unsolved problem, but it's not as unsolved as it was a decade ago. There's more and more progress about background independence results in certain scenarios. For instance, this recent lecture a few months ago by Ed Witten. But why is this such a confounding conundrum?
Well, it's because string theory's perturbative roots demand a predefined background.
However, Kurt, what if you incorporate the Poisson tensor derived from the Polyakov action? Does that not allow for curved backgrounds? Not exactly. Accommodating dynamic backgrounds is different than merely curved backgrounds. It requires a non-perturbative foundation for string theory. But Kurt, what about matrix models or their generalizations like tensor models or higher spin holography?
Great point! You are on it today. The issue is extending those results to a more general setting.
And just so you know, a universally accepted non-perturbative definition remains unfound. This was one of the major critiques of one of the earlier Lee Smolin books of string theory. By the way, a podcast with Lee Smolin was just released about a week ago. Check the description or click subscribe to get notified.
Pure spinner formalism. In superstring theory, an alternative to traditional Riemann-Nevu-Schwarz and Green-Schwarz formalisms exist, and they're called pure spinner formalism. So, what makes this PSF different? The formalism employs what are called pure spinners, quote-unquote, which are a special class of spinners being self-dual and annihilated by a maximal isotropic subset of gamma matrices N.
The formalism also simplifies calculations, especially for higher loop amplitude, using the simpler BRST charge given on screen. Now, this baby girl is less complicated than her counterpart in RNS formalism. The pure spinner space can be constructed as a quotient of the common spinner space that you know and love by the maximal isotropic subspace, represented mathematically here, where D signifies a Dirac spinner and N is the null subspace. These spinners enable a covariant quantization of the superstring, eliminating the oddities of the picture-changing operators as well as ghost fields. Nathan Berkovitz birthed the pure spinner formalism in his pursuit for more symmetric solutions to superstring theory constraints.
Waterfall fields and hybrid inflation.
In new work published in just 2022, which, by the way, is only a blink of the eye in this field, Antonides, Lacombe, and Leon Therez presented a cosmological inflation scenario within the framework of type 2b flux compactifications. What makes their work different? They used three magnetized D7 brain stacks.
The inflation is associated with a metastable de Sitter vacuum, and the inflation is identified with the volume modulus. The authors propose that the inflation ends due to a waterfall field, which drive the evolution of the universe from a nearby saddle point toward a global minimum with tunable vacuum energy. This tunable vacuum energy could potentially describe the current state of our universe. The authors detail their model, including the implementation of what's called hybrid inflation, also the analysis of open string spectrums, and the dynamics of the waterfalls on this de Sitter vacuum and inflation. The authors conclude that their model successfully implements the main principles of hybrid inflation.
The introduction of these waterfall fields in this model is a pioneering mechanism for driving the universe's evolution from a metastable de Sitter vacua to a global minimum, potentially even explaining dark energy.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.